Wow, that was harrowing. My name is Stephen Millett, and I work for DataStax. I work on DataStax Graph. I work on Apache TinkerPop, and the title of this presentation is Extending Gremlin with Foundational Steps. But if you know anything at all about TinkerPop, you know we don't do anything normally. So I have kind of the alternate universe title for this presentation, and that's going to be the mystery of the missing steps. And in this kind of alternate reality, we have Gremlin helping Nancy Drew solve graph mysteries. But before we get to that, I got to start with like the basics a little bit, just get everybody sort of level set. Sounds like there's probably some folks who've done some graph stuff here before, but we'll start with some basics about what a graph is, what TinkerPop can help you do with a graph. That'll be lightning fast. And then we'll jump into some Gremlin and how you can go from being a novice Gremlin user to an advanced Gremlin user. And build on that from there to look for these missing steps and then what you can do to actually go and sort of fill that gap with domain-specific languages in Gremlin. So here's the short explanation of graph. Really, this is going to happen in two slides, so really quick, and hopefully it'll level set the room a little bit. We're talking about a specific type of graph. We're talking about a property graph, which has vertices and edges. Vertex represents domain objects, the persons, the places, the things, and then you have these sort of edges that connect these vertices together, and they represent these directional relationships between two vertices. And then these vertices and edges have labels and properties. And the easiest way to really determine if you understand what a graph is to pretty much look at a picture of one. And this is a picture of a graph right here. So there's that grayish sort of whitish circle in the center. That's a vertex, and it has a label organization, and it has a name property key on it with the value of DataStax. That's our DataStax vertex. Once we have that, if we want to learn more about the DataStax vertex, all you have to do is follow the edges, follow those relationships, those lines, to learn more about it. So in this case, we can follow that line to the left, and we can find out it's an employees label, and it has a property key of since and a value of 2015. And when we get to the adjacent vertex on the other side, we find that there's a label person with a name Steven, and so we have this Steven vertex on their side. So read all together, you're looking at DataStax employs Steven since 2015. And you don't have to stop there. Once you're on the Steven vertex, you can continue to traverse because now you're finding out things about DataStax sort of indirectly by way of Steven, right? So now I can find out who Steven knows if I follow that arrow at the bottom, and I can find out that Steven knows someone named Paris, and then indirectly learn that Paris also works for DataStax. So it's a very intuitive way in which to model data because, well, it kind of mimics how we tend to move about and reason in our actual realities, right? We tend to think of things and their relations to other things. Indeed, it's pretty hard to actually think of a thing without think of it its relation to something else. So if you can follow this picture, you pretty much kind of know what a graph is and can kind of see how data is organized in it. So then how does TinkerPop help you with graphs? So you have TinkerPop is an open source graph computing framework for both graph databases and graph analytics systems. What that really means is we have a set of interfaces in TinkerPop that different graph systems implement in order to get the benefits, they essentially become TinkerPop enabled and then get the benefits of what TinkerPop offers. And one of those things TinkerPop offers is the Gremlin graph traversal language, okay? So, and I'm gonna say the word traversal a lot today, but that just basically means query in graph terms. And we like to use the word traversal because it implies this movement about the graph, that movement that's so intuitive to the directions and the ways that vertices connect to one another. So when you're developing with Gremlin, what you're really getting there is you're getting this agnostic way in which you can build graph applications, okay? So, and this is quite akin to like SQL and JDBC in the sense that the same SQL you write for SQL Server essentially should be the same SQL that would run also on Oracle, for example. And the same Gremlin, the same Gremlin that you write for DataStax Graph is something that's going to work on any other TinkerPop-enabled system. And there's very wide industry support for TinkerPop with over two dozen current graph implementations. So let's look at Gremlin a little bit and dig into it. Gremlin's a functional data flow language that enables users to succinctly express complex traversals on their property graph. Okay, and it's composed of steps that you chain together in order to tell Gremlin how to get data for you. And so the first, this over here on the right, is an example of what Gremlin looks like, and it answers the simple question of who does Steven know, thinking back to our that kind of graph diagram I had a couple slides back. And typically, Gremlin starts with something like g.v. Okay, you see that all the time, where g represents a variable. It could be named anything, but we typically, by convention, say g. And then v, meaning get the vertices. And I like to picture Gremlin getting that instruction himself in the graph, sort of moving about the graph for me to collect the data that I want for my query. So you can imagine Gremlin getting that first vertex in the graph and then saying, well, what do I do next? And all he needs to know in order what to do next is to look at the next step in the pipeline, which is this has step. And Gremlin can see that he needs to look for person vertices, persons with the label person. So you can imagine just flipping through vertices, trying to find that first person vertex until he finds one, and then he looks to see, reaches inside to see what kind of name property he has. And if it's a Steven one, then great, he's found a Steven vertex that he can use that he was asked for. Typically what happens behind the scenes with databases is that they optimize these things so there's an index. So you can almost imagine Gremlin walking around with his ledger looking, you know, he has a ledger that he can look up an index and find a specific vertex really fast. But in any case, once he has that Steven vertex, he looks to the next step and he knows it's an out nose step, which means it's a navigational step, which means I need to move about the graph somewhere. I need to follow the nose edges in an outward direction to the adjacent vertex on the other side. And then once he's there, he says, well, what do I do next? And I look and I have values name. And that just means Gremlin has to reach inside that vertex and pull out the name property to find out the names of the people that Steven knows. So this is a nice query because it demonstrates what I call the three hallmarks of novice Gremlin usage. And it's typically these things: filtering, navigation, and simple transformation. I've kind of highlighted those there on the other side. I say it's like kind of novice Gremlin usage because there's within 2 hours to 2 days, most people can write this and understand what's happening inside of this type of traversal. So congratulations, like if you understand what I just kind of explained in this, you're a novice Gremlin user, no problem. I'm sorry? Yes. And so you, once you have this, once you're kind of this novice Gremlin user, that's also not a knock on being a novice in any way, shape, or form. It's, you can actually do some very powerful things as a novice. With these steps, you're able to easily traverse the graph, touch all the things that you need to touch, reach the different parts, which would be extraordinarily difficult if you were to try to write them in, sometimes in, say, another query language like SQL. What's also nice is that you're only a couple steps away from writing some fairly advanced Gremlin traversal algorithms, like a recommendation algorithm. Really, there's only a couple steps away from writing something very rudimentary in terms of a recommendation algorithm. But what I've been asking is like what, asking myself, is what skill tends to separate the novice from the advanced user? How do you go from that first 2 hours to 2 days to jump over to the advanced Gremlin user where you're building actual applications and doing more advanced things? And I wonder if it's like that's some big wide chasm, or if that's something, you know, does it require tons of years of experience? Does it require a whole lot of steps in Gremlin to learn? And just what is that? And the more I've like kind of helped people on the internet, Stack Overflow and the user list and speaking with users in general, I tend to find that the advanced Gremlin user is really just someone who can easily extract data that they need from a traversal in the form that they want it. In other words, it's very easy for them to navigate about the graph and find the things they want, but when it comes time to sort of shape that data into the form that they need to return for purposes of their application or the services or whatever it is they're building, that's when the more advanced steps need to come into play. And what I think that means is that there's a relatively thin line between the novice and the advanced once you kind of can focus in on those particular on that particular skill set. So I kind of want to demonstrate that now a little bit about how to go from the novice to the advanced Gremlin user, and I'll use a sort of a customer 360 style use case to demonstrate that. To do that, we're going to expand our sample graph a little bit. We're going to add this event vertex type, and it's going to have three new edges in this graph. We're going to have a host edge, which means a person can host an event or an organization can host an event. And an event is like something like what we're doing right here, right? This is Accelerate, and this is a talk on Gremlin. So that's hosted by DataStax. And there's a presents and attends edges, meaning I'm presenting, you all are attending. So we'll use that to kind of demonstrate. This is just the sample data in case anyone ever decides to play around with some of the examples that I have in here, but this is some Gremlin to generate that. Oops. And so now, imagine when you're building your application, you have to consider these questions and these queries that we want to write. These are all novice level Gremlin sorts of queries that I think most people can really understand pretty straightforwardly. The first one we kind of looked at, who does Steven know? We looked at that already. We switched it up a little bit by adding value map, which is a little different from values. Value map is saying convert that vertex that knows the other side of the person vertex, convert that to a map and extract out the name and time zone and put that into a map. All right, so that one's pretty straightforward. That's a simple transfer. That's a filter plus the navigation plus a simple transformation. It'll return a map key value pair, essentially. And then you ask who has employed Steven. Same kind of thing, we find the Steven vertex, we traverse the employees edges, we order those edges by the since, remember our date, since property, and then we traverse to the other side and we value map it. So in other words, we're gonna value map the organization that Steven worked for. And again, order by I kind of consider a simple transformation. Most people that if you strip away the punctuation, it kind of looks like a SQL order by for the most part. So most people follow order by, it's no problem. And then the last one is how many events did Steven attend? And this is again a kind of a simple one. It has a navigational step. We traverse from Steven to across to the attends edges, and we just count up the edges, and we get a count of how many things that Steven attended. Again, all these are pretty straightforward to follow, and if you're following along with me, you're probably a novice Gremlin user. So the out V parallels with the in E, okay? So the in E tells Gremlin, go to the edge and stop at the edge. You don't need to go to the adjacent vertex. You need to give him that extra out V to jump him over to the other side, all right? If you didn't have to order by, because I'm ordering by a property key on employees edge, then you could just skip that. You could just say in employees, and then it would be implied that you want to go to the other side. So when we look at the JSON that's produced by this, by these three queries, you can see that individually we did pretty well as like novice level developers, right, with Gremlin. We wrote some pretty nice queries. We got the data that we generally needed for our application to work. And just take note that in our JSON there, we get kind of this list wrapping there around our keys from value map. Value map does that because it assumes that everything uses multi-properties, and multi-properties just mean you can assign more than one property value to a key. Not everybody uses that. Some people, for the most part, don't even know it exists necessarily, but that's what it does. So let's look at that in the context of, like, again, an application. You've been just playing around the graph. You've been doing this with Gremlin Console. If you use DataStax Graph, you've been using DataStax Studio probably, and you wrote those three traversals. But what you really want is a single traversal that instead of multiple. You don't want three things. You're going to query the same data three separate times. You want to do it once. And you may be traversing the same data more than once, so that's kind of an issue too. And we also want to simplify our collections, right? If we have single cardinality properties that aren't lists, we really don't want our value maps to look like lists, okay? We don't want that. We want a much more simplified structure. And if you look at what we really want is shown there on the right, where we have these specific keys, colleagues, employers, and events attended that we sort of define, and that represents the data that we extract about Steven, okay? And this is we put that all together into one result. And the way we get to getting that into one result is by way of collection construction and manipulation. And Gremlin has a number of steps that are all related to those things, okay? For lists, you can create lists with store and aggregate and fold. With maps, you can use group count and project and so on. The key is knowing, for an advanced Gremlin user, the key is to know when to use these, each of these steps alone or in concert, in order to get your data into the shape that you want. So let's look at how we might do that in this particular case. Again, note that we always start with Steven, and then we're traversing away from there and collecting a local subgraph around Steven that we want to return data about. And then look at the result. We have these static keys that we're defining, colleagues, employers, and events attended, and it contains data gathered by traversing away from Steven. And when you have that situation where you have these known static keys, and when the features of the current traverser are meant to be represented by each key, project is pretty much always your answer in terms of the step. And again, this is just a pattern to know about project usage. So look at how project in action. We see just code block one. We just have a lookup for Steven. Okay, that's pretty straightforward. And then we say, all right, in code block two, we're gonna just use project and look at the output. We didn't tell Gremlin to do any particular transformation to the Steven vertex. So he just created a map using project, and the colleagues, the employers, and the events attended just get that Steven vertex inserted in there with zero transformation. When we're ready to transform, we're gonna do in code block three, we add something called a bimodulator, and the bimodulator just changes the behavior of the previous step that it's associated with. In this case, I just used fold, the fold step, which creates a list of the traversers that pass through project. In this case, it's only the Steven vertex, V0, but you can now see that V0 is now wrapped inside of a list. Okay, so that's the basics of how project works. Now, in this case, I only provided one bimodulator. Bi is applied as in the form of a round robin, so there were three keys, so that same bimodulator was applied to all three keys. If you want multiple, you just add one. You add one bimodulator for each key if you have something different happening. So let's see how we can apply that to events attended key, right? So how many events did Steven attend? And we have that there in code block one. In code block two, all we have to do is, you can see, we just copy and pasted the portion of that novice level Gremlin here into line four. And you can see it projects. It basically takes V0, the Steven vertex, and projects the key using the how many events did Steven attend traversal. So we have to add one bimodulator for each key. Okay? So when we do that, you can see there's a fold here, and we just do this basic transform. I could have just done by. I probably should have done that for purposes of this presentation. I shouldn't have put the fold in there. But it would just been V0 and V0 and then 2. Got me? Now, let's do the same thing to the colleagues key and who does Steven know traversal. What's different about this one, though, is that we need to make a change because we want to get rid of that embedded listing, right? We didn't like so much that we have multi-properties even though our entire graph is single cardinality. So to do that, you use a bimodulator again, this time unfold. It takes the list of multi-properties and basically deconstructs it, grabs the first item out, and that's how you make it look like a map that looks like that, where you just have a single cardinality key associated with it. And so let's push that back into our original traversal. There's code block two. We just copy and paste all of this from code block one down into our bimodulator for colleagues, and now we basically project V0, the Stephen vertex, into the colleagues key. And then we do the same thing for employers, no different. We're using the same trick, sort of the same trick, the same pattern of bi-unfold, and we can project, and you can see this output here where it basically just looks like this. There's our full traversal and our full result that we wanted to have. Now, if I'd shown you this from the beginning and you were a novice level traversal guy, then this would have looked a little daunting, I think. Okay, but when we break it down and we look at it the way that we just looked at it, you can see it's really just three novice level traversals wrapped up inside of a project. And once you can see those patterns, then all of a sudden Gremlin doesn't look as complicated as it might have once did. So I'm gonna build on that now with Gremlin DSLs, okay? And we'll start digging into where the mystery or the missing steps kind of comes from. A Gremlin-based DSL allows traversals to be written in the language of the application domain. Okay, and what that means is Gremlin itself is essentially a domain-specific language for graph. You're writing in the language of vertices and edges. All right, so G.V has patient PID and then this long identification number if this was a healthcare application. But if I wanted to write this in the context of a healthcare application and allow people to query in that particular language of that domain, I might write a DSL that allows me to do doctor.patients and then just the patient identifier. And that would then compile back down to this graph level language. And that yields a lot of benefits because you can hide traversal complexity. If you have a lot of complexity in a particular traversal, dozens of steps all together, it's much nicer if you can wrap that up into a nice succinctly written single step that people can immediately understand. You're going to improve your testability because you can focus your tests in on that particular step that's covering this series of complex traversals. And you're going to improve your code readability overall because one step versus 10 steps, it's kind of much easier to follow. And overall, all three of those things fold down into this last point where you're improving your code maintainability and reusability. So what I think is often overlooked, I've talked about Gremlin DSLs in the past, and I think what sometimes is overlooked is that Gremlin DSL concepts can apply to an application domain, but also to fundamental extension of the graph domain itself. And that's where we start seeing this need potentially for this issue of missing steps. Because TinkerPop isn't very fast to add new steps. We are pretty slow about adding new steps to TinkerPop for a variety of reasons. It's helpful to you all, it's helpful to us, because if we start kind of polluting the space with too many steps, the language gets even more and more complicated. So we're pretty slow about doing that. But let's do a quick example and go back to our kind of expert, our advanced level project statement that we built. And you can see we had value map buy and fold a couple of times. And if you have a single cardinality graph, like you're gonna be writing by unfold a lot. And that's not too nice. So if you flip through all the Gremlin steps, you're gonna look around and find that there's no other easier way to do that. That's our defined pattern as of today. We are working on changing that again, and improving that. But for now, it would be nice if we had something like simple map, which just did that by unfold kind of thing for us. And the way we can do that is through a DSL, and TinkerPop provides this Java annotation processor that helps do that. You basically just create a extension of the graph traversal interface, and you write in your new steps, add this annotation processor on top, and then it just generates all the boilerplate code for you, and you just go. And there's a lot of boilerplate code. You don't want to do it by hand if you can avoid it. That's the Java way of doing things. You can do this in Python and .NET in JavaScript. There's just different mechanics to doing it. It's not quite the same. So here's the example. There's my foundation traversal DSL. I extended graph traversal. There's my annotation. And then look how simple it is to add in this thing. I just add simple map. I proxy in the keys to the value map, and then I buy unfold. And now it's in there. This is just an example of how you would connect to DataStax Graph. I'm gonna kind of just gloss past that one because we're a little behind time, I think. But here's your usage inside of this thing, right? Now we don't have the buy unfolds anymore. Now we're just looking at simple map. And somebody who might be new to Gremlin might know what a simple map is because that's something you've defined in your DSL, but they might have had struggled with what the buy unfold, like why are we doing that in the first place? Let's look at a quite slightly more complex example. Let's say our requirements change on events attended, and we don't want to count anymore, we want actual data. So we build this pretty gnarly looking blob of Gremlin down here, which would confuse a lot of folks right out the gate. We'll blow it up. I'm not going to drive into this in any grave detail as to how it works, but just pick it apart. Like, let's get rid of the stuff that's not, that's advanced Gremlin, let's call it, the transformational steps. Let's just drop those for a minute. Let's pull out the two novice level Gremlin statements that exist in this because they're actually easy to understand. In code block one, we're just saying find all the events Steven attended, order them, and then simple map them, right? So we all know what simple map does now, and that produces a map with name and presentation in it. Code block two, we kind of have the same situation. We're finding the events that Steven attended, we're ordering them, and then we're finding out who presented and hosted them. I tend to think of group, we're gonna group those edges. I tend to think of group as a simple thing. It's maybe not the two-hour to two-day time frame, but you pretty much figure out group by pretty fast because, again, that's kind of a SQL type thing in a sense. But we're doing a group by, which produces a map. So really, I got two maps coming out of this. Really what I'm doing is I'm just merging two maps with all this stuff we've crossed out. So if you go flipping through all the Gremlin documentation, you're going to find we don't have a merge step. We don't have a way to merge two maps that's nice. So you could have merge step. We don't have things like partition. We don't have interleave. We don't have zip. I mean, flip through like closure documentation, all the different types of collection modification options that you have. We don't have all those things necessarily. So let's try and add them in. Here's merge. It takes a series of traversal maps that will produce maps that we will then merge together. Okay, so an arbitrary number of maps merged together. And then when we inject that back into our original traversal, look how much more straightforward that is, right? When I do merge, people will know there's two there's maps there, and it's much more succinct, much more straightforward to follow. For fun, I'm just going to throw in partition. These are really neat traversals to pick apart just to try to understand what that next level is. Daniel Kupitz came up with this particular implementation of partition. I had it done a different way, and then he made it like better, which is what he does. But you can see you can partition two and take a list of values. I used inject in this case. We inject a list of values and partition them into size block twos or size block threes. Same thing here with interleave. This is a nice use of index, I thought, to build interleave, where you can take a series of lists and then you take the first item from each list and string that into the stream, the second item of each list, string that into the stream. And I built those two because I thought this was cool and important to note. If you build your DSL steps at the right level of composition, they become things that you can structure into other DSL steps. So here we built zip on interleave and partition, and you can see what that does, right? We get it provide two lists, A, B, and C, 4, 5, and 6. The A, B, and C are the keys, the 4, 5, 6 are the values, and it merges them together to produce a map. And look what zip hides. Like, dude, if you had a reason to have zip in your application and you had to have all this and it was exposed just generally throughout your application code, someone coming along to read this is not, it's gonna take them a minute to figure out what's going on. So DSLs can really help hide that kind of complexity. And I'm not saying go out and just go build zip randomly, like build the steps that you need for purposes of what it is you're doing. You may not need zip and interleave or any of those things, but when you find those gaps, this is the way to fill them. And I'll leave you with this one, just some Gremlin DSL resources. A number of blog posts, the first three are blog posts that I've written. Even though they're for specific languages, if you're for Java, no reason not to read the other ones. They all have good information in there that really isn't programming language specific. And I think that's about it.